why this course and what we intend to achieve in the next 2.5 days.
The organization is IT for Change. We've existed for about over 10 years now. And we initially, when we used to have workshops or conferences or seminars with women's groups, with social justice groups, we used to have this kind of attention in the room. There used to be social justice activists who used to outright deny that technology had anything to do with justice and would believe that we are extremely techno-deterministic. And so dealing with a group of Luddites, you know, people who didn't believe that technology is really something or it is even real, used to be a challenge. Then over a period of time, there used to be, there was a certain flavor, you know, which was that the ultimate horizon of emancipation for women is the internet. So then that was another kind of problem, because one was swinging to the other side and we would have this kind of thing that, you know, it's a, you know, all a sobering moment, and Snowden suddenly happened. You know, you all know that Edward Snowden came out and revealed what the NSA was actually doing. And then it almost seemed like some kind of equilibrium in the discourse had been achieved. So there is a lot of, I think, things that we need to know. There are ambivalences, there is some confusion, there is some optimism, and some of us, in the meanwhile, partners like Anandi and Kach Mahila Vikas Sangathan and IT for Change, who have been working on the ground, we have been actually finding out where exactly, you know, is that core where we can say that women can become empowered, and what are those conditions under which women can really use technology. So rewiring women's rights debates in the digital age is actually a learning space for all of us. It's a space where we would like to frame issues, we'd like to debate issues, and feel free to ask questions, engage in debates that seem like extremely trivial, because those might also be very vital in helping us move towards clarity. Oftentimes I find that as a woman, as a feminist, and as also a person interested in gender justice, working towards that in very real ways, struggling with women who are not like myself, women who come from different positionalities, there is this dilemma. You know, I'm so sick and tired of my mobile phone because it's constantly ringing, and you know, somehow I have, you know, developed a way by which I will not attend calls. I'll call back my friends. Sometimes I have these calls that come to me which say, "Madam, I'm calling from Tata Docomo. Do you want another connection?" Someone else is saying, "Hey, you have not paid the bill," and all of these things. And so sometimes one tends to, from a middle class positionality, take this view that, we are actually emphasizing the potentiality of technology to really redeem or to bring about some renaissance, you know, too much. Maybe that it's not really valid. But I'd like us to keep this question in mind constantly through the next 2.5 days as to which woman are we talking about, what kind of conditions under which we are envisaging the technology will be used. And thirdly and most importantly, as you will discover through these 2.5 days, thanks to our resource persons, what technology are we talking about? I mean, is it one internet or is it multiple internets? Or is it internet under certain contingent conditions? And I would really like us, when we're talking about being wired, rewire our thoughts around, you know, are we talking about the same thing when we are talking about the potential of digital technologies? Just like all of us at some stage in our life, you know, we discovered this lens of gender and it seemed like windows were opening up. I don't know how many of you had this experience, but certainly, you know, as an adolescent, I would feel very indignant. I would hate to be, you know, groped in public spaces. And then when I joined my postgraduate degree and I took up a formal course on gender studies, it seemed like, boss, so many people have thought about these things, thank God. And those theoretical lenses somehow are very, very emancipatory, right? So I'd like you to also revel in the joy of the theoretical lens of the network society.
So on your own terms, please, through the readings, with the resource persons, with your peers, in this space, go ahead and find out, is there a kind of a disciplinary domain called network society? Is it worthwhile having? And just as we all discovered the lens of gender to uncover the world, you know, is it possible to also have a lens of the network society to uncover the world? And indeed, if the two were to be brought together, and if we were to feministize the network society lens, then how would it look? You know, so that would be a very interesting thing. Just the other day in our office, day before yesterday, I was horrified actually. I fell off my chair when we applied for a clearance with the Ministry of Home Affairs for an international conference we are holding end of this month. Now, those were the days when the ministry, you had to call and then nobody would come to the phone, and then someone would have to go to Delhi, then you would have to pull a string or two, or, you know, all of that. And then finally that clearance would come after a lot of heaving and sighing. We had a clearance on email on Monday. You know, Ministry of Home Affairs, one image file, you know, had landed in my email. So I was really completely pleasantly surprised and also very, very shocked. So in some sense, this reveals to us that the operations of the state, the workings of the government, are foundationally transforming, not just in their procedure. It's a big normative change, right? I mean, for anything to change in government, it takes eons. We all know that. Slowly it will change. But this entire thing also shows that there are many other issues, you know, issues of trust, issues really of social norms, issues of relationship, the social contract even, you know, at some foundational level between the state and the citizen as to, is there an accountability that the government has towards civil society organizations that they should respond to them, giving them, you know, a response on email? So what is really happening is that we are seeing institutional shifts. And so this course is really about not only thinking of a gadget and how it could potentially, quote unquote, you know, in some paternalistic way, help a poor woman. It is not really about that. It is about something that is more foundational, something which is at the level of institutional change. So I think this is another thing we'd like you to keep in mind. And in our journeys together as practitioners, Anandi, Kutch Mahila Vikas Sangathan, and IT for Change have really, really, I mean, the debates are many, but we still struggle with the basic issues of access, with the basic issues of connectivity, etc. And in spite of all of that, we believe that if only a panchayat were to be connected, how wonderful it would be for a woman to receive a message. The other day, we were discussing with the UNSCAP how it's quite ironic that some of the PDS-related messages of food grains reaching the local shop, the ration shop, why should it come to the mobile phone of a man? After all, the household economy is usually run by women, and in most poor households, it's actually the women who are taking responsibilities around feeding their children and feeding their families. So if the PDS system is sending an SMS, an automated message saying that the food grains have reached the shop, shouldn't it be reaching the mobile of a woman? Immediately that leaves you with the question, do all women actually own mobile phones? So these questions will remain, but let's not get lost in these questions, because I think those polarize the debate. I mean, are we really talking about us and them? And because let's understand that it is very, very true that by 2020, the whole world will be connected by mobile phones. It's actually true in terms of the projections, and our resource persons will share more about that. So in many ways, I also want us to do this very conscious exercise, because it's a very packed course. Wish we could have all spent a week around it. First, there was this constraint of resources and the constraint of time, but maybe we will have other moments to do this. One very important thing I want to say is, we are men, women, queer people, all of us here in this room. But we are also, let's not forget, we are also data in different machines which are silicon based. So we are human flesh and blood, but we are also data. It's undeniable, because what we see in the kind of, UID oriented state is that we are trackable subjects of the state. We are also memory in so many videos. So we are so many things. We are certainly embodied, we are certainly embedded in our context, but we also seem to be, in the deterritorialized forms that we take, something else. So in this kind of hybrid condition that we are, how can we re-envisage, the quests around, or the questions around rights, social justice, gender justice, etc.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I'll just be trying to quickly take you through what we plan to cover in the next 3 days. So to start with, the main aim of this course, what we seek to do over the 3 days, is to try and identify what can be the critical concerns for democracy, gender justice, and accountable governance in this current context where the digital is reconstituting almost every sphere of our lives, whether it is the public, political, the social, or the economic. So one of the first principles or the starting points that, I would just like to explicitly mention here is that we find it extremely useful to analyze the digital, not in opposition to the real or not as something dichotomous to the real, as in if you position it as this is virtual space and this is real space, there are limits to the analysis. Because it's very important to understand that the digital space is like deeply embedded in the existing socio-political architectures, and it is structured by the values, cultures, power systems, and the institutional orders within which it is located. So this course primarily tries to give you a dipstick or a glimpse into how the digital is actually a socio-political artifact, and how the power play, the contestations, and gender orders, what are the implications for this in this emerging space, which is so tied to existing socio-political architectures. So as you would have seen in the copy of the agenda also, there are three key main thematic areas that we plan to cover. One is that, how are women's rights getting recast in the current context in this network age? And there we want to try and identify key concerns for women's right to privacy, security, bodily integrity, public political participation. What are the challenges? What are the new ethical dilemmas? And some of the sessions, I will not be taking you through the agenda in detail because you all have copies. Some of it tries to address this theme. The second theme that we are trying to address is about how governance is changing today. And what we really feel is that governance systems are becoming increasingly data-driven, as Anita has also already mentioned, right? And when governance becomes increasingly data-driven and the citizen is reduced to a data point, what are the concerns? When you talk about how a citizen, especially citizens who belong to marginalized groups, have to make their rights claims on the state, what are the concerns? This set of debates will also be addressed. And finally, we talk about the part about where in this context where when you speak about technological diffusion, hardly 12% of users in the world of the internet are Indians, and hardly like a fraction of our population uses the internet. In this context, if you're speaking about how can women appropriate technology, what does it mean for the last woman, the last rural woman? What does it mean to speak about appropriating or harnessing the digital opportunity for empowerment or for engaging with the state? We'll also try to contextualize this question. So I'll just leave you with something that the famous sociologist Saskia Sassen said, that when you think of electronic space, it's important to think of it as an analytical borderland, this emerging space where the maps are still not clear and the terrain is just emerging. Thank you.